H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys supports 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus. One-time pay, lifetime access to live classes and videos. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For free demo class, visit h2kinfosys.com.
So let's get started. So the first thing about SQL is it's a database, which is basically, it's a structured database. So it is basically used to store the data in a tabular format so the data can be retrieved properly. So when we talk about structured and non-structured data, so tables, spreadsheets, and all these are structured data. And when we say non-structured data, I would say tweets, emails, these are all non-structured data. So the first thing is that, so SQL, it stands for Structured Query Language. It lets you access multiple databases, and it just became a standard American ANSI in 1986. And so there's a thing called data warehouses. So it's like a central repository of different databases all together, and we can retrieve the data that way. So that's the basic thing about SQL. So now SQL has a lot of advanced things. Now it's just not tables from where we retrieve data. We have procedures, we have triggers, we have jobs which can automate all these tasks now. So it's not just limited to retrieving the data using queries. So let's go to SQL uses. So SQL can execute queries against a database. It's used to retrieve data. It can insert records, it can update records, it can delete records, it can create new databases. It can also join databases now. It's used to create stored procedures, and it's create views, and we can set permissions, etc. for that. So first thing is relationship database management system. So that is the basically, so how do we relate one table to another? So the first thing, please let me know if I'm going too fast and if you don't understand anything. These are just basic stuff which will not be very useful. This is the basic introduction to SQL. So the first thing is relationship database management system. So suppose we have two tables. So just imagine this as a form of Excel that we have different columns. So we say that we have an employee table. So employee table, for column A, we suppose we have an employee ID. For column B, we have a name. For column C, we have a department ID. And for column D, we have like details about an employee. Now we have another table, which is the department table. So now for department table, they'll be asking they will be having details about the department. So they'll also have a department ID. They'll have the department name. They'll have the on which floor the department is located, etc. So now for these two, we need to understand how the data moves. So for the first table, for the employee table, as we notice, the column C has a department ID. And for column A of department table, column A has a department ID. So if you want to reference, if you want to find out which employee is in which department, suppose this employee A is in department 3, but we don't know what department 3 is. So in that case, we have to reference these, we have to join these two tables to get the data about what department is department 3. So we will be using different kind of joins for this, so that once we have the joined table, we'll have all the details of the employee and all the details of the department. Is it understood?
Yes.
Okay, so that's a basic overview of RDBMS. So what we use in day-to-day lives is basically RDBMS now. So we have different kind of which I'll be coming later, but we have a different kind of keys, we have different kind of joins, we have constraints to make sure that all the conditions which we want to have on a table is fulfilled. So we'll be covering that later. So RDBMS is the basis of SQL. All the modern databases such as MS SQL Server, IBM DB2, MySQL, everyone is using RDBMS. The data in the RDBMS is stored in the form of tables, and a table is a collection of related data entities, and it consists of columns and rows. So just tables is basically a matrix, a spreadsheet, which has columns and rows. So that's the basic structure. So this is the employee, just an example of a basic table, an employee table. So we have ID, we have name, we have age, we have city, and we have the salary. So this is just a basic structure of a table. So these are table columns and these are table rows, also called records or fields. So these are the commonly used SQL commands. So first is select. So select is basically, it's telling us which table to select. Then we have update. These are all DML statements. I'll be covering what are DML statements in the subsequent slides. Then we have delete. If you want to delete a record from a table, then we have to use this command. Then we have insert. If you want to have new records in a table, then we'll be inserting the data using insert into. Then we have the basic create databases. So a database will have multiple tables. So suppose I have to say that I need the data of all the customers in a company. So in that case, we'll have the data of customers. Suppose one will contain all the customers with their addresses and phone numbers. Another table will contain all the details about the sales of a customer. So this way, the customer database will store all the tables containing the information about a customer. And those tables will also be referenced with each other so that we can access the related information. So suppose if you want to say that, okay, tell me all the customers who stay in city New York and they want to, and how many sales they have made in a month. So this way, if you want to retrieve relevant information about a customer, we can use the database and use the useful tables for that information. So, and then there's alter database. So suppose if you want to change the name of the database, suppose we want to do add new table to the database. So we have to use alter database command for this. Then there's create table, which will create a new table in that database. Then there's alter table. If you want to have to modify the characteristic of a table, suppose before that I said that there would be 10 columns with different kind of strings in that. But now I have to say that I want 15 columns with different numerical characters in it. So in that case, we have to alter table. After that, we have drop table. Suppose a table is completely useless to us, so we don't need it anymore. So in those cases, we have to use drop table. Then there's create index. So index is basically, in case of a book, so we have an index to understand like this is where the data is located. So for fast, so when you have millions of rows, so we have to have a faster retrieval of data. So in that cases, we have to create an index so that data is retrieved faster. So we don't have to go through like 10 million rows to get the 11th million row data. So we can create an index on that so the data is retrieved faster without going through the top-bottom approach. It goes through a physical locator address and logical address. That's a complicated computer structure process, but we'll just stick to that. It helps in faster retrieval of data. And then there's drop index. So if we don't need such faster, because when it index is very fast when it comes to retrieval of data, but it slows down the performance of a SQL database. So that is one of the interview questions which comes very frequently, like indexing is good for a database or not. Are we clear about this commonly used SQL commands?
Could you repeat the create index and drop index, please?
Yeah, sure. So when you talk about index, so just imagine we have indexes in our books, right? So it's similar to that. So suppose you have, if you have, like, let's take 100 rows at this point of time. So suppose we have 100 rows, and that will get sorted by the how it's stored, unless we do an order by. So once you have 100 rows, so when you want, like, suppose your data which you want, suppose you want the data of a customer who is named Jim, that person is stored at 77th row. So instead of going through 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 till 77th, if you create an index, it will use the logical address of the record and it will straight away jump to 77th row. So this way, if you want the data in a faster way, we can create an index on that. So so that will just help us to get the data which is present in 77th row. This is how create index and how indexing works. And we have to drop index because when we it will be faster retrieval of data. So the data will be faster. But if you have a lot of indexes created on a table, it will slow down the performance of the database. Is it clear now?
Yes, thank you.
Hello, how to use it in this one also, the SQL query? Means, can you just give us an example?
So 100 rows, 200 rows records we don't have in our tables. When we use it in a regular basis and in our office work and etc., we have a lot of data. So suppose my job needs me to have a lot of data pulled in on a weekly basis so that I can do a dashboarding on that. So let's take my scenario. So I cannot wait for, like, because now it has, like, data since 2016, 17, and since the customer obsession segment came into Uber. I cannot go through 2016 and all the inflows we have, like every tickets we have every day. So in that case, we have created an index on that so that I can straight away go to the weekly records, like the latest week records I have in my database. So I don't have to go through.
Where clause is like an index? Where clause, when we add the where clause or the...
No, it's not just a where clause. It's the where clause will actually also do it, but where call uses a top-down approach. So it will start running from top to bottom. So it will start running from 2020 till this date. But for indexing, if we have to create, a separate index for that. So we have to suppose change the data structure. So we will not. So there are two kind of indexes, actually three: cluster index, non-cluster index, and unique index. So what cluster index will do that? It will just change the physically how the data is stored. So it will not store the data like, okay, I have, suppose we have 2020 data stored at row one. So that's when the row number concept comes into picture, which we'll cover later. So we don't have, so it will, what cluster index will do that? It will not store 2020 into row number one. It will bring it to bottom and it will just change the physical structure of the data. So it will just start, if I create an index and if I want the 2021 data at the top, so it will change the physical structure of the data and it will bring the 2021 data in the first row. Understood?
Not that much actually clearly, but no, once you will this one, so show us in the actual this one as the example, we can able to know.
Sure. We'll be covering the indexing part and how to create indexes later. This is a basic. So this is about indexing. So I'll cover indexing as a separate topic. It's a nice topic. Cover.
You said cluster index, non-cluster, and what was the third one?
Unique index.
Okay. So what is the command? Is there a command for it? Like certain commands?
There will be a lot of syntaxes. You don't have to worry about that. It's just that right now, just like there are divided into three parts. Clustered will physically change how the data is stored. Non-cluster indexes, and there will be only one cluster index on a table. And there can be 999 non-cluster indexes on a table. And what unique index will do that, it will just sort the data based on the uniqueness of records.
Okay.
So we'll be covering the index part. So then probably you'll have more clear picture once we have the syntax and the examples ready. So moving on. So talking about the database type. So like we seen that create table part. So when we have to define the structure of a table, we have to define like what kind of data it will take. So suppose we have a table which has 5 columns, A, B, C, D, E, whatever columns, like just imagine as a spreadsheet. So A, B, C, D, 5 columns are there. So now for this, we have to say that the column A, suppose it will have ID, second column will have name, third column will have department ID, fourth column will have address, fifth column will have phone number. So when I talk about ID, it will always take a numeric. So that's when I have to define that it is a numeric data type. So we'll talk about the syntaxes later. So it's like create table, then I'll define the column name, and then I'll say numeric, and I'll give it probably 10 characters length. So that will be like create table XYZ. Then there will be columns name A, and then it will be numeric 10 characters. So 10, when I write like numeric within bracket 10, that means that column can take up to 10 numeric characters. So it will be, it can be 1, it can be 100,000. So moving on to date time. So suppose we have another column which says that date of joining of an employee. So that we have to define as date time. Then we have character string, that is varchar, that is mostly widely used. That suppose we have names, we have the addresses, so all this will have string characters. So in that case, we have to define it as varchar. Then we have binary, which is 0 and 1. Then we have Unicode and varchar. It is not widely used, binary white Unicode character. And then there's miscellaneous glob, blob, XML, JSON. We don't really define all these. So the column commonly used ones are varchar 1, varchar and varchar 2, numeric, date time. These are the most widely used. Sometimes we also have Boolean. So Boolean will have true and false value only.
Could you explain float? I forgot.
A float is basically the decimal number. So if we have 1.0, that is a float. And 1 is a whole number.
Okay, so it says big int, decimal, and then numeric and float again. So decimal and float is the same thing?
No, it's not the same thing. So when we say float, so It can hold a value of 1, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3. It's similar, but decimal will have values up to 2 places and it will round it off.
Okay. And what is a real?
Real number, I think. Never used it, never became handy. It's real number and complex numbers.
Integer and integer.
Yeah. Moving on to the SQL commands. So this is one of the very commonly asked questions. So when it comes to interview point of view also. So there's DDL, DML, DCL, and TCL. So DDL is data definition language. DML is data manipulation language. DCL is data control language. And TCL is transaction control language. So when we say data definition, so as the name suggests, that it will just define whatever we need from a table, right? So we'll have create, alter, drop, truncate, rename. All these are defining the definition of a table, right? So we have to, so these are the commands which will help to define the structure of the table and how do we want the structure. Then there's data manipulation language. So we'll have select, update, suppose if you want to have to change the data, insert, we have so it will include new data, we have to delete, we have to merge two data. from two separate tables, and then this lock table. So lock table is something we'll cover later, because that's in comes in the ACID properties of databases. So that's atomicity, consistency, isolation, and durability. So this is comes on lock table comes under isolation, so that so when we do manipulations on the data, so the data, suppose I'm doing some kind of manipulation, my manipulation does not get, so before I commit that manipulation, that suppose I want to show 10 more records in my table, before I commit that, no one else should see it. So we'll cover that later. So this is a basic, what is lock table. Then we suppose we have certain databases which are, we don't want others to see those databases. So in those cases, we have grant and revoke. So we are, want to give selective access to the databases. So we have to add the username, and we have to grant them those accesses, privileges. And for revoke, we have to, suppose once the user has left the organization, so we don't want him to have those accesses, so we'll just revoke those privileges. Then there's transaction control language. There's commit, rollback, and save point. So commit is basically, it will commit whatever transactions we have made so far. So that is basically once we have updated or insert. So after every DML statement, we have to make sure we write commit. Otherwise, the transaction will not take place. So to make sure the transaction, we have locked in the transactions, like this is the transactions we want and this is the data we want, we have to write commit. Rollback, suppose we have included an incorrect transaction. So in that case, we can roll back. And then save point. Suppose we have a lot of transactions going on step by step. So after every transaction, we can write as save point A, save point B. So any case, there's a power failure or we have lost the transaction, so we can go back to save point A, and till that point, it will be again done. Any questions about this one?
Well, hi, Krishi. This is Samir here. So I have a general question, not regarding with, what the duration of this course is actually, and what we gonna learn actually, is this more related to the testing or development of the SQL?
No, it will be about SQL completely, how to retrieve the data. So testing is a different subject altogether. So it will be more like, I would say, development, yes, a little bit. So SQL is not really development unless you're writing procedures. But yeah, so suppose we for retrieval of data. So what kind of profile do you work in?
Currently, I'm not working actually, but I did some manual testing and all. And then after, I'm still learning with the Selenium.
Okay, yes. Okay.
Yeah.
So, about that, so what kind of profile do you want to get into? I would rather ask.
I wanted to ask, what's your purpose of teaching, and towards the development part or towards the testing part, or towards what kind of a profile I can be managing, you know what I mean?
Okay, so there will be no testing because testing is altogether a different segment. So there is a lot of database testing. Once you do a little bit of deployment, there's a quick record checking and stuff like that. But that's not something which is covered as a subject altogether. So coming back to the roles which will help, SQL is used in kind of roles. So it will be any kind of business intelligence roles. So when I talk about business intelligence, I would say so wherever we want to have a lot of analysis on the data, SQL has to be there. You have to play with a lot of data. So any business analyst role, any business intelligence role, or any data analyst role, all these roles will have to have SQL. SQL is the bread and butter of these roles. So for that, you need to write queries. You should be able to write different kind of procedures. You should be able to pull in data from different sources. So we have to do a lot of joins. That's the whole idea about it. So we have to, so it will not be just one or two tables. It will be 10 tables, and you have to get the structured data in that format. So once you are done and you have all the like you have more control on the commands and how to write those commands, that's how it's going to help you.
Okay. Are you going to give us a lot of this one also practice how to write down KSQL?
Yeah, absolutely. Actually, I'll be sharing you links. So it will be better that, so I'll be probably helping you out with lead code questions, HackerRank questions, so that you have a real life example. Because once you are like going for interviews and stuff like that, it is very important. So they'll be asking you to write queries. So that is one of the basic, like whenever you go for an interview, they'll ask you to write a lot of queries. So for that, you have to have the real life experience, like how should that. So they'll be giving you one table with a lot of records on it, and they'll be asking you, okay, fine, I want this record or in this this record in this format from this table.
Okay.
So in those cases, I'll be giving you those tasks so that you can start working on it. So like basic tasks one by one, and when you have the concepts clear, you can move to the advanced part.
Okay, so can we get some kind of this one, some homework at home so that we will able to kind of, you know, work on it?
I'll give you, yeah, absolutely. Like, you can just go to, I'll just send you the links. You can just go to, like, I'll give you a few things in the class, and after that, you can go back and you can just browse through the website, and they have a lot of questions.
Okay, that's great. That's great.
Yeah, and you can just start working on it. So, get errors, like if you don't cannot figure out the error, you can ask me. But yeah, it's very important to get errors, I would say.
I agree. Yeah, and one more thing, how many days means the duration of your course?
I think around 15 to 20 hours, depends on the flow, how it is going.
Okay,
so
go ahead.
So I don't think it will take more than that to get through the concept. See, I would say that I will never say that you can, like, by the end of the course, you will be like so proficient in SQL that you'll be able to write procedures, big procedure. I would not say that. I can give you the direction towards SQL because I know that I also took a lot of time, like, to understand SQL. So, like, I started working on SQL back in 2016. And, like, I would say, like, till 2019 also, my concept of SQL are not clear, like, though I was working for 3 years. Because I had, like, there's so much in SQL, like, suppose, like how it can deal with databases, it's really complex when it comes to complex, like how to get the data in a complex manner.
Okay.
So it will definitely help to get over, like, to understand the concepts, to how to get the data and everything. So, yes, after a lot of practice, yes, you will be proficient.
Yeah, but that is what, can we get that type of...
I'll just want to share what kind of things go on. Let me just show you also.
Yeah. Actually, you know what? I have to attend another this one, Selenium class right now at 9. So, can you able to change this one timing next time? Then 8 to 9 instead of 8:30 means we are here at 8:30.
Right now, it's what time it is out there?
8:30. No, sorry. Right now it is 9 p.m. But you are this one. So class started at 8:30, and we have to go to another this one class for this one Selenium. So from the next time, if you change the timing, just half an hour early, it will be the best.
Half an hour early. Okay, sure. Does it fit everyone?
I think you have to ask everyone and ask.
Yes.
Asking everyone, like, is the timing okay with you all?
It's okay with me.
Okay. Just a second.
Can you please send me an address so that I will be able to talk to you later?
Yes. Just one second. Okay, so this is HackerRank. You can all go and enroll for it. So, Femini, are you going to send the video to us? No, I will not be sending the video to you. H2K Infosys will be sending the video to you.
about the video. Read that.
I'm sorry.
Can you repeat your answer to that question? You say you know. You say you are not going to send the video.
No. I'll not be sending. So the H2K Infosys will be sending it to you. So they'll be providing you with the link or however they send it to you, or the Google Drive link.
Okay.
So I'll not be doing. They'll be sending you after the session.
Okay, great. Thank you.
So this is HackerRank. So this is where you can go and practice, and I'll be giving you questions from here as well. So where is it? Okay, so this is SQL. So these are the questions we get. So like this is a basic select query. So this is how it comes, like query the name of the table. So I have a few questions in my slides also. This is one. So suppose we want to query this data, so we'll have different, this is the format we have, and we'll give given conditions, and we have to just input it. And there's another one. Once you are comfortable with SQL, so yeah, once you're comfortable with SQL, this is like advanced SQL. So once you are done with the HackerRank questions, which is like it's basic. So these are the questions which you can practice after that. And these questions are like pretty standard. Even the easy questions are pretty good for this one. So I'll be bringing you this also. I think this one requires subscription, so just check it out. Okay. So going back to the PPT. Are we clear till now? Any questions so far?
Oh, so Krishri, are you gonna teach us like Tableau also, or just a SQL actually?
Tableau will be a separate training, so you have to get in touch with them. So because I also conduct a Tableau training, so you have to get in touch with them, and they can assist you how to enroll for that one.
Oh, okay. That's a totally separate course, then, like?
Yeah, it's a separate course. Tableau is also, when we say a SQL, it's just data retrieval and data manipulation and databases. And Tableau is basically giving it a visual format. So whatever data we retrieve from here, so we can have it in a visual, have a visual representation of that. So that is for the business end. So they're like, when it comes to business end, so business will not go through the tables and records and they'll try to figure out. So suppose we have to show the sales over a period of time. So we can just take this data, put it in Tableau, and it can just show a line graph or a bar chart over a period of time. So that's the basic why Tableau is used. So for dashboarding, so that business can see how they are performing over the time.
Okay. So do you also teach Tableau like in H2K?
Yeah, I do.
Okay. And what's the duration of that course like?
Tableau will not take much time. Tableau would maximum take 15 hours, like, because Tableau is mostly hands-on session. So I'll be teaching you and you'll be doing it at the back end, because it's not a theoretical course. To get and hang of it, it's a very easy tool. I will not say it's a very complex tool, but it's a wonderful tool. Like, I really love Tableau. So it will not take like more than 15 hours. Like 15 hours is more than enough to cover it all.
So one thing, one more question I have like in my mind, since you have told us like this is not for the development part or not for the testing even. So being as a tester, or we cannot test this the SQL queries, right? We cannot test the backend database, right?
We can. Actually, basically, it's not like we don't. So that's basically, there's not a separate testing team for this. We don't say that there's a separate testing team for see how the records have flowed in. It's up to us only. So even when we say SQL developer has to do it all. So yeah, probably there will be a separate team to check the performance and etc. But usually there is no separate SQL testing team. It will be all us, like we have to check how the data is performing, how much time it is taking, how the query is doing, what kind of records we are filling in, so is there any bad records or not. It's all up to us. So we have to make sure that when we pull in the record or we get the record, there's no missing values, or there's no bad records. Suppose they are not columns which are exceeding the length of, like, suppose we have said that, okay, this column will have a string with 50 characters only, and we encounter a string which is supposed 55. So we have to make sure that such records do not flow in. So it's up to us.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. So yeah, so that's the overview. Before we move forward with this one, this is a basic SQL command, so basic select. So it is used to choose all the records from a table. The data return is stored in a result table and it's called a result set. So when I was saying about employee tables, if you do a select star from employee, it will choose all columns from the employee tables. There's no filtering, there's nothing. It will just give me all the records which are present in the table. So there are 100, so we'll get 100. So this is a syntax for it. So select star from employee. Okay, so suppose we don't want all the columns, so, and that also slows down the performance. So we'll just say that we want the names of the employees which are present. So in that case, we'll just say that select the ID and the name of from employees. So we'll just, this will what it will do, that it will just give me the ID and the names of the 100 records I have. Okay, then we have select distinct. So in that case, we'd say that, so it is possible that we have two names, like two same names in the same table. So suppose we have two genes. So we'll say that, you know, I want just the names which are distinct in the table. So we'll do a distinct on that. So it will just give me the records which are unique in that table. That's what this is. This will do. So it will be like select distinct name from employee. Is it clear? Do you have any questions for me?
No, I don't have. Thanks.
Okay. So before we move forward, so I want to get into SQL like completely. So this is the overview. If we like get started in the next session, I'll start covering the SQL and I'll start making you write a little bit of queries. So this is how I do. So there's count. So I don't want to start count. Count will take some time. Okay, so this is the SQL operations, and these are the practice questions I have. So I'll just go to the where part, and then we can. Okay, so it's like how to deal with the data types. So for SQL strings, it needs a quote around it. So suppose when I say about numeric, and I say varchar. So varchar2 is basically, it will have, numeric will have just numerical values. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, this is all numeric values. Varchar will be like A, B, C, D, E. Anything which has a alphabet is a varchar. Alphabet. So it can have A2, A3. These will also be counted as varchar. So when I say where is basically used for filtering. So this is where. So where it's used to cause, clause is used to use filter records. So suppose from table 1 and 2, we have, so suppose we want to get all the employees living in the city, New Delhi. So we'll be like select star from employee, where country equal, where city, it should be city. I'm sorry. Where city is equal to New Delhi. So it will just give me all the records which match this condition. So suppose there are 5 records who are staying in New Delhi. So it will be just giving me back 5 records. So this is how where is written. So before we move forward, I think this one can be done. Do you want to practice this one? Let me just give you an overview of the question. So there's this table. Let me just draw also. Okay, so there's this table probably. This is ID, this is name, this is country code, and this is district, and this is population. So this is the table. So this is ID, this is name. Excuse my handwriting. It's country code, then this district, and there's population. So it will have few records on this. Okay, so we need to find the city from in the city table with the population larger than 100,000. So this is the condition we have. So we want just the population greater than 100,000. Do you want to try this one? Is everyone able to hear me?
Yeah.
We can hear you now. We can hear,
yeah.
Hear you now.
I'm sorry?
We can hear you now, but before we can't hear you.
Okay. Where did you lose me? So I just wanted you
after
to try
you
out this.
Draw-
Yeah, okay. So I just wanted you to try out this question. So it's a basic select statement, and it will just like it with the filter condition. So do you want to try this one? So it will be just a basic practice.
Where do we try that? Which platform are we going to use for that?
No, just write it on a in the chat. That's fine. You don't have to use a platform for this. You don't have to run it. You just have to write the simple query. So I'll just help you with the syntax. So this is a basic syntax. In case you just have to replace the columns here. Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it's correct. This is what I have.
Okay. Okay, select star from table. Okay, it's correct. The idea is pretty correct, but I'll just share the exact. No, it's fine. You missed out the where clause, because if you don't give the where clause, it will not filter. So when you give a condition, you have to have a where clause in front of that.
Okay.
Okay, so the first thing is that, so here the table name is city, so you have to like select star from city, then where population greater than 100,000, and the quotes are not needed. So I'll just give the correct query. So it will be select star from city.
Okay, we can't see the which.
Okay.
Okay. You're writing.
I wrote the wrong one. Wait, I just pressed enter to go to the next line and it just sent it. Population. Yes. So this is the correct answer. So what it is doing that, you have to select star from city. So it will first iterate, like it's pulling all the records, but we have to give a condition that where population is greater than 100,000. So what it is doing that, it will just bring out the records which have a population of greater than 100,000.
All right, thank you.
Okay. And about the quotes, the quotes will only come into picture when we have a string. Suppose we had the same query, we had to write the same query, but it said not population, it said name. So and name cannot have a greater than or less than, it will just have equal to. So it will be like name equal to probably Jim. I don't know what kind of records are in there. So, sorry, I would say. So, yeah. So here we use the quotes because it's a string. So it's a varchar. So, where we say varchar2, it's basically this will have string characters. It will have alphanumeric characters or just alphabets. Is it clear now?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. So that's the solution for this one. So we can conclude this class for today, because I think we have to jump into the more detailed part one by one. So this is just the overview of what we are gonna do.
When do you use like?
Like is used. Suppose we say that. Florida and Florence. Suppose we have cities, like I'll say in this, so this is a table structure. In the table structure, we have records, right? So we have like probably we have Florida, we have Florence. Okay, so these are two records which are probably present in this table. So we don't know, like, okay, fine, probably we don't know the exact how it is stored. So suppose someone has, like, for in the while writing the data, someone has written the spelling of Florida wrong. So in that case, Okay, so what it will do that, it will where name like. Okay, it will just give me like. So yeah, so this, can you see the see the chat?
Yes.
Yeah. What it will give me, so it will give me like whichever name starts with FLO, it will give me those records. So FLO, after that, it can be anything. It can be RIDA, it can be RENCE, it can be anything. So it can be like, it can give me back 10 records with starting with FLO. So the first three characters will be FLO. So after that, it can pick up anything. So in
how
those
do we
cases,
know when to use equal and when to use like? Sometimes
equal is basically, I'll say that I just need New York. I don't need anything before that. I don't need anything after that. I just need New York. So that's when you use equal. Suppose I say that probably there's a center called like New York Association of United States of America or something like that. Okay. So we don't know the exact name. So I'll say that, okay, fine. I want something that starts with like whatever centers are there in New York. I want something which starts with New York. And after that, I don't know what records will be there. So in those cases, we'll use like. So I would just say just overview, like I would say just like when we're certain that these are the records which are present, we'll use equal. And when we are like uncertain that there can be things which... So when there can be things like we are not certain about it, so in those cases we use like.
Hey Christy, I have one question.
Yeah, sure.
These queries that you are teaching us, are these used? Can these be used on MySQL or SQL Server?
It can be used on both actually.
Okay, so there won't be any changes on both of these?
Not much, like very minute changes. Like if you know MS SQL, you can use on MySQL. So there will be like a little bit of functions here and there, but the overall syntax and everything is the same.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Okay, any other questions?
The course could be like, and I know you did say it depends, but can you give me a frame time of like?
No, it will be around 20 hours, not more than that. It will be around 20 hours, so to cover all the topics which are required. So I would say just say 20 hours. So plus or minus like here and there, 1-2 hours, but yeah, around 20 hours.
Okay.